All right, I pray that you all are having a wonderful day in the Most High Yah. And even if you're not in the Most High Yah, I want to talk to you about something that's going to impact all of us, okay? So there are some things that are common to all men and women, and this is one of them, especially if you are in the U.S., but I do believe that it's going to have a global extension, just as people utilize credit here in the U.S. who are located around the world. It's going to impact them as well, and it's going to impact the end users of that credit. So if you're someone who's looking to make a purchase of a home, a car, you know, extend your credit line, loans, whatever your needs are, okay? So in a few weeks, let me just say, you can see by the title what I believe this is in summary. Okay, hopefully I put it there, but I'm going to read this article to you. By all means, do your own research as far as reading, looking up, possibly going even to the FICO, Experian sites, and Finicity as well. Perhaps they can help you, but also listening to other people online, okay, who have done their homework, who perhaps even work in that industry, I'm sure that they'll be able to provide you with much more information than I can. What I have found from listening to them, though, I do need to let you know, is that there are conflicting views. There are those who say this is going to be good. It's going to raise some people's credit as much as 150 to 200 points. Others who say this is going to be a nightmare. I say that it just depends on who you are and what your situation is. And I think for the most part, it's going to negatively or not work for the benefit of most people. That's my opinion. Now, there are going to be people who are going to benefit from this, but those are usually going to be people who have access to cash, who have money that they can just leave sitting in their account, or they have partnerships, be it family members or friends, and they'll be doing some of the things that they do when they are doing other types of credit stuff. So I don't want to get into that, but I'll just say that for a lot of people, this is not going to be good. All right. But you do your own research, you know where you are, and you determine how it's going to impact you, or how you believe it's going to impact you. Okay. So what's going to happen is Experian, FICO, and a company called Finicity are going to launch an Ultra FICO credit score. And most of you may know that the FICO score is basically what lenders look at when they determine if they're going to extend credit to you, and how much, and what your interest rate will be. Okay, but they're coming up with a new Ultra score that basically, if I had to sum it up, means cash for credit. If you have the cash, we give you the credit. All right, so let's see what these people have to say. The launch of a new Ultra credit score said to have potential to improve credit access for the majority of Americans was announced by Experian. So they're saying it's going to improve for the majority. Okay, but let's keep reading. Experian, FICO, and Finicity and the Money 2020 USA conference was announced basically at the Money 2020 USA conference. The new score will launch as a pilot early in 2019 and should become available to lenders by mid-year. The new Ultra FICO score, according to the firm's, leverages account aggregation technology and distribution capability from Experian and Finicity to help consumers improve access to credit by tapping into consumers' contributed data, such as checking, savings, and money market account data that reflects responsible financial management activity. So automatically, if you don't have checking or bank or savings account, that's going to impact you, as you can see, negatively, because that's what they're going to use to determine whether or not you are credit worthy. Okay, so let's continue. And the type of checking as well. Consumers grant permission for the firms to get access to information from bank statements, including how long accounts have been open, the frequency of activity, and evidence of saving. Finicity electronically reads those statements and combines the data with consumer credit information from Experian to provide an enhanced view of positive financial behavior. Okay, so they're going to determine whether you have positive financial behavior based on your bank account, what your bank statement says, how frequently do you make deposits, how what are your bank activity looks like, you know, are you saving, So if you're not saving, if everything you bring in has to go out because that's what's required for you to be able to pay your bills and to exist, if you're paying your bills on time, they're not going to even consider that really, because they're looking to see if you are able to save, okay, and how much, and evidence of savings, as it says. Okay, so the model was developed by FICO. You can go and read all of that there, but I want to skip to this where it says, according to Experian, FICO, and Finicity, the new score could improve credit access for the majority of Americans, particularly those who fall in the gray area in terms of credit scores, in the upper 500s to lower 600s, or fall just below a lender's score cutoff. They also expect that those who could benefit the most are consumers with new and relatively limited credit history, or those who are digging out from earlier financial woes, which I find this to be very interesting because, once again, it's going to work for those who have had access to money and cash, who also still have access to money and cash. And in the past, although they had cash, they did not pay their bills for one reason or another, may have ended up filing bankruptcy. But it's going to benefit, a lot of times, it's going to benefit the people who, once again, know how to play the numbers game, know how to gain access to funds and hold it there long enough to get approved, and who basically know how to work the system. That's what I'm seeing from this. For those who, you put in 2,000, you need that 1,999, or you need 2,001. Okay, so that's going to be something that's going to really, I think, negatively impact those who have limited access to cash. But if you're someone who's had past credit woes, and bankruptcy that stays on your credit for, say, 7 to 10 years, but you now have access to cash, you have a steady flow of cash, you can put maybe 2,000, because I've heard it, they're going to require as much as 2,000, or from 2,000 to a couple hundreds, and some people say even more depending on the lender and what you're needing. It just depends on a lot of variables, okay? And for those who are really, the type to need credit just to make it through the month, okay, it's really, in my opinion, going to have a negative impact on that segment of the population. But those who may have ruined their credit or had life experiences that resulted in their credit being ruined, this is going to be an opportunity for them to jump back, snap back from that negative reporting there. Okay. Now, I don't think this is going to help those who may have had student loan write-offs and such. No, I think it's just basically going, those factors are going to stay in place. But for those who have access to cash, it's going to make a big difference to them. Okay. And also, I think it's going to have a negative impact on all of us in the sense that it's going to give more room for predatory lending. Even if they extend the credit to you, they know that it's worth more now because it's limited as far as who can access that credit. So although they're going to give that credit to you, it's going to be at a higher interest rate. Okay, that's just my prediction on this, but I could be wrong. At the end of the day, I think merchants need to sell their goods, and so they're not going to they're going to do their best to make sure that people have access to their goods, but at the same time, they know that there's a greater demand for lending. And so because there's a greater demand for those funds to be released, they're going to make us pay in the end. Okay, so what should we do? Pray and try to move towards cash, move towards a place where you can afford to live. And in my opinion, I just think that this current system that we are in, it's too much for most people. Most people cannot afford to live, cannot afford to rent in the US. Okay, I listen to people say, I can't afford to move. You can't afford to stay here. Right? If you can't afford to save $5 a month, $10 a month, which many people cannot, I think a lot of it is based on spending habits and choices that people make I honestly do, and that and the facts reveal that. When you honestly take a serious look at your finances, no matter how limited you are in finances, if at the end of the month there's not even $5 left in your account and it wasn't spent towards some necessary utility such as electricity, gas, car payment, insurance, those things, then there's an issue there. There's a leakage there that can be stopped to where you can at least save $5 a month. Okay. And so, yeah, we have to examine ourselves and our habits. And we also have to examine that the system is working against us. And they're not about to reduce those rates. They're not about to consider that your income has not increased. They're just going to keep demanding more, because they know that at the end of the day you're going to scramble and try to come up and come up with those finances to meet those demands. All right, so that's my take on this whole issue. I hope that it helps us at least with information. Reach out to others who are more experienced, and like I said, for some people it's going to work for them well, for others it's not going to work so well for them. Okay, y'all help us all. Shalom.